Happy Jesus to all you out there, amen. Straight Talk Live, I'm your host, Dr. T.J. Straight. Thank you, praise God, for you having me in your home tonight. And, man, I thank God for the word. The Bible tells us, amen, man shall live by bread alone, by every word that proceeds out the mouth of God. It's going to take God's word that's going to heal, save, and deliver. It's forever settled in heaven. In other words, God spoke, and it's forever settled. What you mean? Steadfast. That's something that's irrevocable. You can't change it. God spoke something, and it happened. You find that in the book of Genesis, amen. And God said, and it was so. 119, 7, verse 89, forever, O Lord, thy word is settled in the heavens. So we thank and praise God that there's some things that cannot be ever erased or changed. Irrevocable. And speaking of that, Jesus made a statement. They was messing with him, and it's not good to mess with the master. And he said something to him in the 10th chapter of St. John. They was in a dispute because Jesus said that he was the Son of God. And they ready to rock him, ready to stone him. You know, them Jews, blasphemy. They ready to jack him up. And what I love about this part here, Jesus goes on here and say something here. He tells them in verse 29, my Father which gave them me is greater than all, and no man is able to pluck them out of my Father's hand. I and my Father are one. You hear that? I and my Father are one. We one. Now, when they heard this, the Bible said, then the Jews took up stones again to stone him again. Now he a Jew, that knows the Bible said, and the Bible said, then the Jews, which is supposed to be Abraham's seed, the ones that sat there and said that they not be born of fornication, but they have one father, which is Abraham. And Jesus said, he know you Abraham's seed, but you seek to kill me. I mean, told you the truth. And Jesus said, they said, you got a devil. Anybody seeking to kill you? And Jesus said, I have not a devil. You do the deeds of your father, I do the deeds of my father. And then they said that God is our father. Yeah, they called him. Now they say, God is my father. We'll go back to the 8th chapter in just a little bit of St. John. And Jesus said, you of your father, the devil. I love that part there. He said, you your father, the devil. And unless of your father, you'll do. Now, wait a minute. Previously, they called Jesus blasphemous, an imposter, a devil. And they said, because he said he was the Son of God. And then look, if me and my father, we are one, I'm his seed. Jesus said that God is his father. That's his offspring. Oh, you're getting deep now. Now, we was born one time of our mother's womb from the dust of this earth. And now we are born from above now. The Spirit of the living God presides in every born again believer. God's Spirit resides inside of you. All right? Now, Jesus is talking plain. So I'm going to talk like Jesus. You have to want to have to crucify him all over again if you just want to argue what I'm saying, because I'm born again. But the Bible said, then the Jews took up stones again to stone him, and Jesus, and verse 32 of the 10th chapter of St. John, Jesus answered them, many good works have I showed you from my father? For which of those works do you stone me? He said, works. That means healing, delivering, casting out devils. I done done all this in showing you that God with me. Now, if I am a man of God, and I tell you something, said God told me to say this, then God's got to back it up. Signs follow them. You say you're a doctor. Well, how many surgeries have you performed? What is your practice? What do you do? You're a cardiologist, dealing with the heart, neurologist, dealing with the brain, a dermatologist, amen, praise God, dealing with skin. I mean, what are you? Well, you got to have something to show. Them papers on that wall ain't nothing. You got to be some type of practice. Something. If you're a lawyer, okay, your first case, what was it? Amen. Domestic quarrel, whatever, something. Got to show something. Well, if I'm a preacher, I got to show that. Anybody can get there and poop it. And God said, I'm coming back on a cloud of glory. Yes, I am, says God Almighty. Oh, okay. Bible goes on to say, Jesus said in verse 33, the Jews answered him, saying, for a good work we stone thee not, but for blasphemy. And because that thou, being a man, maketh thyself God. Now, people, even in this day and time now, I'm telling you that God heals, save, and deliver. He will take the sugar out of diabetes. Amen. What I'm saying? He'll give you a new liver. Amen. And he will take the sugar out of diabetes, the heart out of heart attack, the sin out of sinner, the home out of sexual, the AIDS out of AIDS, amen, the can out of cancer, the heart out of heart attack. He's God. And God would do all that stuff, but then people say, well, I don't believe all that. Well, you don't know God. You saying you doing it. No, see, that way you keep going wrong. You ain't taking God's glory. But I'm not, now I'm just going to be a little bold. As Paul said in his sixth chapter of the book of Ephesians, where he said that, as for me, that a door of utterance be open, and I may open my mouth boldly to declare the gospel, you know, boldly to speak the word of God. And so, and now we've been cooped up too long. We've been sitting up here trying to just sugarcoating the word of God instead of just saying, amen, the impossible. And then the impossible happened. God would cause that garter to fall off you, or that mold to fall off you, your body and stuff like that. So Justin got scared to say, thus and thus say God. And because we're afraid to say it, therefore, amen, God is inoperable in our lives. He's not able to show that he is able to do that, because evidently we think we're doing it. And a lot of ministers, that's where they go wrong at. They're scared to tell their congregation the truth. You're going to hell. Woman, you're going to hell. Turn that man loose. You know, they ain't going to say that. They're scared. They're afraid of telling people that God has the truth. They want friendship. Instead of, amen, have God to be their friend. Abraham was called a friend of God because he believed God. Against all odds, he goes down that hill down there and draws a knife and starts cutting his foreskins off of men. And they start saying, they want to look at him like, and God gave him circumcision. I mean, when God give us do certain things, we just scared to do it. Now, something's supposed to take place. If it's God, it can stand any investigation. Now, Jesus go ahead. Now, he hit him with the scripture. The Bible tells us, what is it, the 8th chapter, I think about verse 20. Yeah, of the book of Isaiah. To the law and testimony. They speak not according to this words because they have no light in them. In other words, when they start to tell you, go to wizards and go to witches and warlocks and to them that peep and mutter, should the living go to the dead for an answer? Well, that's what people do instead of going to God. They'd rather go to some witch doctor instead of going to God and then going to God's man. God keep his stuff in order. I love the way he works. In 10th chapter of Acts, God tell Cornelius to go by the angel, go down there to Joppa and find Simon Peter, lodging a man in Simon's the tanner's house. Now, why couldn't, somebody said, well, why couldn't God just spoke to him himself and said, what do you need to be saved? Because it's not giving the angels to preach. They don't understand about the message of salvation. They desire to look into this thing. It's a mystery unto them for what God done done. But God gave that charge to Peter that he will open these doors. He, I give you to the keys of the kingdom. Amen. And God sent them, fulfilling his promise. In the 20th chapter of the book of Revelation, we see about 12 thrones, and thrones were set, and they set upon these thrones. He promised the apostles that they'll sit upon 12 thrones, juggling the 12 tribes of Israel. You find that in the 22nd chapter of St. Luke. God means what he said. So, you know, you have to repent. Sometimes you've been slow in believing God, slow in speaking God's word. Moses got involved, got in trouble doing that mess there. Amen. Going smiting the rock when God told him just speak to the rock. That pushed Moses too far. Now he knows better. He got himself in trouble. Because of that action, he couldn't go into the promised land with them. Moses had an ending. Now here we are right now in this day and time. Preachers are afraid to tell folks the true word of God because of their religion won't let them tell the truth. And shame the devil. Well, look, Jesus go ahead on and start saying something to these guys, and they want to rock him. They want to give him a face of rock group. And they said, but you made yourself being a man. Knows the word now. Being a man maketh thyself God. Now, listen to what Jesus said in verse 34. Jesus answered them, is it not written in your law? I said, you're gods. Now, that's Psalms 82 and 6. Now, the New Agers say that we are gods. In that, they speak the true word of God. But their definition of that is dead wrong. They saying that there is no God. We are God. And that we, in other words, they don't acknowledge the Creator, God the Father. If our spirit came from God, that means we have a part of God in us. They don't acknowledge that. They acknowledge one thing, that we are God. I mean, with a capital G. No, I'm not. See, I'm a shepherd. Small s. Now, sometimes you might say up there, senior apostles in capital level, that's just for the graphics up there, but no, the Bible talks about the chief shepherd in the book of Peter. When the chief shepherd appeared, he shall give you, amen, a crown of life. That chief shepherd is a capital S. The chief apostle is a capital A. You see, Jesus is God. Jesus is the chief shepherd of the sheep. I'm a shepherd. When God comes back, what did the scripture say? He's king of kings. I am a king. Scripture tells me that. God says that. I am a Lord. The word Lord there, like you said, Lord Upperston, Lord Steubenberger. Huh? That word Lord there means ruler. And the Bible said, thou shalt not revile the God, small g. That means the Lord's. Now, Jesus, King of kings and Lord of lords. He's the. Nebuchadnezzar was a king of kings. But he's not the king of kings. Get this now, Dr. T.J. Straight. I am a king and I am a Lord. but I am not the king. And I'm definitely not the Lord. I got a small K and a small L. Catch that now. Now, that's scripture. Revelation, God, through the blood of Jesus. And so we got that raw blood. Remember that now. Through the blood of Jesus, that blood that washed all our sins away, we're born into royalty now. And we are, I say, I don't have no problem with these what y'all call prosperity preachers that goes and they use their authority, they use their right that they can have anything they want and believe in God for that. And they practice the Abrahamic covenant with God, and we being children of Abraham and like precious promises and all that. I have no problem with none of that stuff at all when it comes to that. But when you just start making prosperity all about that makes you saved because you got rich, your riches and stuff like that, and you can just say whatever you want to say about God, amen, and that makes, and your money proves that. No, I don't go with that now. I'm not into that. Some people do not need to know the deepness of riches because it's deceitful. And if they don't have no pastor that are teaching about money, they're in serious trouble. They're going to get in trouble. I'm telling you, they're going to think that gain is godliness, and that is going to be one of the very things that Satan is going to be using in the last days. It's talking about that money, materialism. But Jesus, my point right now, I'm trying to show you that I'm talking to you that born again, that you are children of God. You got rights. You're citizens. You got rights. People, before I came on, I didn't feel like coming on and doing this broadcast tonight. I didn't, but I did because this is what I do. This is my life. So I live to do. Amen. But when it comes down to be challenged and try to make me like a punk, a suckbuck, a rooty poo, amen. No, you can forget that. I am who I am. I'm a child of God. I'm born again. Heaven is my home. I am an ambassador of Christ. I am a king. I am a Lord. I am, amen, praise God, what God has made me to be. I've grown into maturity and realized who in the world I am. I cast out devils. Sick is being healed through laying of hands in my life. The works that Jesus did, I'm going to do also. And I do just that. That's why I got that number on that screen for you to call. Those that's up under my ministry has an anointing upon their lives. They're able, praise God, to do, amen, exploits. Casting out devils, healing the sick. That's the authority God gave us in the body of Christ. So get with that. Can you handle that? Can you get to that? The Bible goes on and say, now Jesus said in verse 35, if he called them gods, unto whom the word of God came, and the scripture knows, that's why I said earlier, scriptures cannot be broken. Why can't you break the scripture? Because it's the word of God. The word of God. You can't break it. It's unbreakable. It's everlasting. God breathed that out. God spoke it. He ain't taking it back. Now, if God called us gods, and unto who did he speak this word to? He spoke it to them Jews. You are gods. Now, they get ready to get crazy with this. I hate when people get there and they're trying to be just so human that they ain't no heavenly good. Just say what God said. You can't get in no trouble for that. Then it goes on to say, now the Bible said in verse 36, say ye of him, whom the Father has sanctified. Okay. Are you saying who God has sanctified, set apart for his use, talking about Jesus, and sent into the world, thou blasphemy, because I said I am the Son of God. Now notice that. Now he's making it plain and clear. Because I said I'm Son of God, the one that God has sanctified and sent into the world for a witness and a light and a testimony. You going to say I blaspheme when God just went and gave you the scripture? And verse 37, if I do not the work of my Father, believe me not. Okay, if I'm not doing what the Father, God, that's the word, that capital F, the Father, capital F. But if I do, though you believe not me, believe the works that you may know and believe that the Father is in me and I in him. Therefore they sought again to take him, but he escaped out of their hands. These people are doing everything in their power to accuse Jesus of blasphemy. People, folks would love to rub mud on my face. They would love to throw the egg on your face. They would love to make me stop telling what does say God. Because they can't live up the standard. They're trying to please other people. Now, I'm a preacher, and that's what I am. I'm not going to change it. I am a man of God. I'm not going to change that. So through all the heretics out there, and all of you out there, you blind God leaders of the blind, and to all you that's so-called arrogant and everything else and try to put us up so high, saying we exalted, we just ain't low as you are, you low down little snakes in the grass, you generation of vipers, you son of snakes. So all you get out there and just want to argue with the Word of God, you have it your way. You got that Burger King mentality, you know, hold a pickle, hold a lettuce, special order, don't obsess. All we ask that you let us serve it your way. Go ahead, have it your way. Jesus said in 11th chapter of St. Matthew's, wisdom is justified of their own children. So whatever you say is right, is right. Whatever you say is wrong, it's wrong. 16th chapter Proverbs, the ways of all men in his own eyes is right. In his own eyes. He see it. Yeah, I'm writing this and that. Well, it's my belief. See, people, I thank God that I got a guideline called the rule, the canon, the Bible. I thank God I got this book right here. I thank God for that. And that way, by having that there, I'm able to, amen, govern myself. But I have the Holy Ghost. I have the Creator inside of me. And I'm saying to you people out there in radio and TV land, because y'all so afraid and so scared to tell the truth, that either you're born again or you're not. You're saved, sanctified, filled with the Holy Ghost, sanctified and set apart for God. I ain't say for the world, but for God. You're special. You're unique. You're fabulous. You're marvelous. You're uniquely made. God made you that way. Now, he separated you from your mother's womb to be his. The Bible says every child, male child, first male child to open the matrix, the M-A-T-R-I-X, before that movie came out, I was telling everybody about it, the rebirth. The word matrix simply means womb. And any male child come out that was sanctified to God, that first male. They was God's. They belonged to God. You know, just like the priest get the first animal from the flock, the same way it was, the first male child was God's child, belonged to the Lord. He was consecrated to God. But now, all of us, everyone that God have ordained for him. In other words, He pulled from every family. God said he would take two of every family and one of every city and bring them to Zion, give them pastors according to his heart that will feed them with knowledge and understanding. Don't take this, amen, praise God, as a joke or some mistake, amen, or some epiphany. This is for real. It's no mistake that you just tuned into this broadcast and you're hearing Dr. T.J. Strait on the air. There's no mistake behind it. See, I can reach millions of people where I'm doing right now. And God put you up under my watch. And God put you up under my care. Because your family going to reject you. Yeah, you can get prepared for that. The moment you get saved, I'm telling you, your kinfolk going to reject you. They're going to call you a nut. And y'all still busting your butt trying to please everybody. It ain't going to work, man. Can't. Because oil and water ain't going to mix. Light and darkness is not going to mix. The devil and God do not get along. It ain't going to work. The opposite. Totally opposite. You know what I'm saying? Try to take two magnets and stick it together. And every time that magnet going to flip. It's going to flip. There's no way that Lucifer, that lying rascal, the devil, Satan, Beelzebub, the dragon, the serpent, the Leviathan, they cannot cohabitate together. Amen. Not with God. Them demons, them Amons, them Wiccans, they can't hook up with the angels of God, the seraphims and seraphims. They can't. Because they're different. I'm telling you, how many times you have seen a buzzard and an eagle together? Different. But they birth different birds of prey. But you don't see a buzzard killing nothing, do you? Not too quick. But you see an eagle, he have fresh kill. Buzzard eat garbage, eat carrion, stuff that got maggots and everything in it. They nasty birds. But good thing for them because they keep your road clean. And buzzards, that's what they do. Hang around old dead pine trees, dead trees, everywhere. That's where they lodge at. They don't swoop down and grab fishes like eagles does. They don't swoop down and grab rabbits like eagle does. They want some already dead. And that's all Satan have to offer you is death. I mean, he find out that you love money, you love sex, you love illicit sex. He gonna work on you with that. That's the devil for you. And see, you wanna sit there and be fashion models and showing your body all off to the world. Who want that? Who want you? It's messed up, but your life gonna have to change, folks. When you get saved and you come to Jesus, I'm not talking about the way a lot of these folks got you walking around in August and July and August hot sun with a collar way up on top of your neck and got a dress so long you tripping over and falling over. You can't even stand up and everything. Just get on your knees and dress and try to get up. You're going to tore it off. No, I'm not talking about that. I'm not talking about these crazy people that got things to say you need therapy. Because, amen, you watch a movie on TV, because you watch TV. There's a lot of stuff that's happening. A lot of things going on that people, and they make you righteous because God told them you're going to spend less time with television. God convict their heart than he teaching you, amen, their convictions. You see what I'm saying? Paul said that he wished that every man would be like him. But God gave every man their proper gift. Every man can't be like Paul. Paul was Paul. I'm not even trying to be Paul. I'm just serving my Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. The same way in that area, you got to know how far to take people. Some people don't have the faith that you have. So that's why God said in 14th chapter of Romans, if you have faith, have it unto yourself and God. Because some people don't believe they can eat chitlins and stuff like that. Well, if they don't believe they can do this and stuff like that, then don't go making them do this and do that. They don't believe they can eat chitlins. They don't believe they can eat pig feet. Some people don't need no pig feet. I told that daughter of mine the other night, yesterday. I said, then I tell you, why you got to keep on giving her them pig feet? I don't know. She buy them. I don't buy them. But she cook them, I eat them. I said, stop it. I don't usually eat them. I said, didn't you, when last time I eat one? Well, it's been a year since I ate one. Didn't you just eat one last month? Yes, sir, but, you know, I didn't buy it. I said, never mind. I said, I guess I just raised you wrong. I don't care. Eat all the hog food you want. I ain't got no problem with it. I can count how many times I was talking to a guy today about some my homie, my maid, that she always buy me that old-fashioned stuff. He bought me two cans of something and sent them to me, sent them down there to me. And they was something called hominy, white hominy and yellow hominy. And just the other day before then, I run across that. I looked and seen that can of that hominy. Boy, I ate the whole can. I might have swallowed them before I chewed them because, it's been years since I ate hominy. Years. I remember when we used to make them when I was a child coming up, when they would make it with that, make it with the pot ashes and stuff. They would make that stuff, make lye soap and all that. But I ain't got no problem with folks that ain't got no faith to eat lye, homie. I ain't got no problem with people that ain't got no faith to eat corned beef. I'm not going to put that on nobody. But you better have faith enough to do this. If you ain't got no faith, no take no communion, you ain't saved. What, now? You ain't. Somebody done funked up your mind. Where you get the fact of the matter that I can do all that, but I ain't gonna be fooling that communion. I ain't gonna be fooling with that. You drinking whiskey and everything else, but you can't go there and take communion? You got Thanksgiving, Christmas coming up, and y'all drinking that eggnog with that scotch off inside of it, and you can't take communion? Wow. Let me see. Something wrong, see? But that's different. That the Bible instituted that. That's an institution into the body of Christ of communion. We take communion. That's definitely, it's not a ceremony, but it's something that we do. We practice that. Because Jesus said, do this as often as you remember me. So, you know, you remember God every day. Don't mean you got to take it every day. But you got to do that, take communion, because that's what he did. Why would he tell Paul to tell the church that? Paul told about when you come together to take the Lord's Supper, 11th chapter book of Corinthians, you take that communion. Putting you in remembrance, and it's a powerful thing. That in his body, he took all your sickness and diseases and took the beating that you should have got. Jesus had no reason to get whipped. But he took all your sickness and diseases in his body, and that's remembering that you don't have to die with no cancer or heart or inflammatory diseases. Amen. Praise God. Degenerative disease. You don't have to die with that. That's scripture. He took that in his body, and then the blood or the grape juice that you take, that grape juice, that's for, because the blood, his life for your life, the sinless for the sinful, the holy for the unholy, the righteous for the unrighteous, the just for the unjust, the pure for the defiled. And even your conscience, you have to remember when you was a child and you stole a cookie out of the cookie jar. How many men you slept with, how many women you slept with. He'll paint your mind with his Calvary's blood. I'm going to give you power to forget. That's what the power of communion is all about. So I take communion. It's to remember and to forget. Remember for what God done for you and forget about what you done that was wrong. That's why it's important. Now, why you think the devil don't want you fooling with that? Ain't nobody scared of communion but the devil. And a lot of y'all Christians, they call yourself Christians, church going, you better start getting bold. Are you saved or not? Are you born again or not? Are you still hanging around with the same salacious, evil, wicked, amen, defiled people that you, amen, once, amen, was with, going back that way? I'm telling you, God gonna mess it up. 10th chapter of the book of St. Matthew, a man's house, his enemies, they of his own house gonna become his enemies. His foes, F-O-E-S, enemies, M-E-N-E-S-I-W-K-Y, apostrophe T, enemies. You gonna become they enemies. That's what the Bible says. So that's what happens. Your own people going to serve you up. Your own people going to do you in. Ain't that a pity and a shame? Well, that's scripture. And I'm telling you, you come with lip, I'm coming with script. I'm giving you a dip, and I ain't talking about snuff. I'm telling you what does say God. So your nature going to change, man. Your attitude going to change. Everything about you, amen, places you used to go, folks you used to run with, you're gonna feel withdrawn being around them. I'm telling you. Why? Because eagles want to be with eagles. And as an eagle stirs his nest, so does the Lord, your God. They mount up on eagle's wings. For you are the wind beneath my wings. God wants you to be on his wings so he can teach you how to fly. He wants to teach you how to glide, amen. He be that wind beneath your wings. Breath, ruach, spirit. That's what God wants to be in your life. So it's up to you people. His name is Jesus. But I'm not going to, not one from one iota of a megabyte of a centimeter of a second going to turn from God's word. I ain't buying down to what the devil say. I'm saying what thus say my God. Yes, sir. Until God tell me I can't eat it no more, I want me some steak and potatoes. You hear that? Someone sent me a nice, juicy T-bone steak. It was in Theodore, Alabama. It was me and Brother Grant and his wife, Brenda. We stopped at, some restaurant. And before I could get the menu good, he said, I know what you want. You want that steak. You want steak medium well with the potatoes and steamed vegetables. I said, how do you know that? That's what you want. I said, yeah. I said, okay. And I'm simply got a cold sore on my lip. And he's trying to offer me some of his food. I said, man, you offer me some of your food. I'm sitting up here embarrassed in front of y'all like this now. But I wanted that steak so bad to eat it right there. And God blessed me to have that, and even at my age, not even right now, I say I love them steaks. I mean, I like steak, if I can get one. Some of you right now, you're running from a steak. A nice, juicy, amen, steak. And you know what? A little small steak, no bigger, well, I don't have nothing that size here now. No bigger than this. a steak, well, you it won't be that big. No bigger than that. That little strip right there is going to cost you $17. Now, if God can bless you to buy a $17 steak, which I know a lot of you ain't going to do it, and God bless your body where it can ingest it and digest it, and you don't want to take that because the Jews ate steak. They love beef, cow, oxen, and stuff like that. But see, here we now with all this health freaky stuff that's going on and vegans and all that stuff there. And I said, man, look, I'm just telling y'all right up front, people. Y'all worried about the body. You'd be worried about your soul. Because see, that's what people are more concerned about right now. It's the thing that's going to die, which is called the body, than they are about their soul, which can burn in hell forever and ever and ever. Make up your mind. Labor not for the meat, the Bible says in the 6th chapter of the book of St. John, that perish, but meat that has eternal life. Also in the 6th chapter of St. Matthew, the same thing. That lay up not for yourself things on this earth, because they're going to perish. Lay them not up because thieves break in and moth do corrupt your gold and silver with canker. But lay up in heaven that true treasure, what Paul declared 4:17 of the book of Philippians, fruit that may abound to your account, your heavenly account. And see, I can draw, I'm drawing out right now. You know, when you get old enough, you can draw pensions, you can draw, amen, money and everything else. You can even park in the handicap zone. But anyway, you're laying up in heaven, so you got something laying up. God warns us in the 12th chapter of the book of St. Luke, beware of covetous. You see what I'm saying? You can go and put all that stuff up on this planet and you're not rich towards God. And when your day of trouble, and it will come, you ain't got nothing to sustain you. Because you ain't laid nothing up in heaven. Earth to heaven, beam me up, Scotty. And so I'll be trying to tell people left and right about laying up for themselves. Man, I don't want your money. I'm not asking you for nothing. What I want you to do is to have some fruit that may abound to your account. That when that day of trouble, and it's upon us right now, and this country is in serious trouble. Let's see what they got. Now, let's see if their money and silver and gold is going to save them. According to the 7th chapter of the book of Ezekiel, say it was iniquity, that's stumbling block. It's what caused them to fall and fail. They're going to cast their silver and gold in the street. Buy gold, gold, buy gold, buy silver. All right. Notice right now, you ain't getting back to normal, is you? Everything that changed. In the moment, in twinkle of an eye, it changed overnight. You woke up and... You woke up the next day, got awoke, a thing called woke, and look what you're living in. Nothing is certain, is it? Nothing is certain. Every time you turn around, something changes. They done fix you good, duping you, making $10 an hour or $15 an hour, and the food prices and everything is sky high. And you know, I didn't think about it. As I was going to the other day, amen, the prices for your parts on your vehicle. Well, you once could pay $50, $40 for a battery. Man, batteries are $125, $150, right at $180 for a battery. car battery. Lord, truck drivers, beware. As a man, I'm gonna park in his truck. What you parking the truck for, friend? It's costing too much, man. They know how much that diesel is to load that thing up. I got 100 gallons on each tank, both sides. Ain't cost me about $700 just to fill this thing up. Didn't I tell you? Didn't I tell you? And so I told you, but no, you didn't want to hear that. Now you listen to Straight Talk Live. I'm your host, Dr. T.J. Straight. You're going to live for Jesus or not? His name is Jesus. Are you going to call upon the name of the Lord or not? Are you? Are you going to say, Lord Jesus, I know I need to be redeemed. I know I need to be saved. I know my life is definitely not right with you. I got more holes in my life than Swiss cheese. Lord, I'm sorry. But I believe your minister tonight. I believe if I come to you sincerely in my heart, Lord, and ask you to save me and change me for the better, you'll do it. I know there's no other way. For me, there's no other way but you, Jesus. And I come to you. You said if I come to you humbly and ask you to forgive me of all my sins and transgressions, you'll do it. Lord Jesus, I come to you right now and ask you to cleanse me with your blood. Wash all my sins away. I want to remember you and forget my past. Cleanse me right now, Lord, for I'm forever yours on this 15th day of November. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you for coming in. Thank you for saving me. If you're a backslider and once knew God and turned away from the Master, turned away from him, while the blood's running warm in your vein and while you're upon a conviction right now, you should say to the Lord, Lord, I'm not even worthy to be called a child of God. I'm not worthy, and I know it. I transgressed, I sinned, and I know I'm wrong. I don't know really how to say I'm sorry and how to repent, but I do say I'm sorry, and I repent. I'm really and ready to make that change. Jesus, have mercy on me again and wash my sins away with your blood. And I'll serve you with all my heart for the rest of my life. Come on in, Jesus. Come on in, Jesus. Father, to everyone that prayed that prayer and said those words, I pray that God, that you know that they mean it, for you know their hearts. But I pray to God that the Holy Ghost will come upon every last one of them. And if you're filled with your spirit, and you remember the words that I've given to them, for you're the only way, Lord, the only way from earth to heaven, from sin to be born again. Jesus, I thank you right now. I thank you, Father, right now for hearing the prayer and let them know that God is not me, but it's you that save and heal and deliver in Jesus' name. And I pray even to be a sign and a token to them out there that was sick in their body, even in their mind, to be totally healed right now. Totally healed. That spirit infirmity is gone out of that body, out of that mind. And restoration is taking place spiritually, mentally, physically, financially, and socially in Jesus' name. In Jesus' name. Amen and amen. My friend, if you said those words, there you got it. I'm out of time, amen. Never out of messages. Tomorrow, 1 o'clock, amen. Listen, don't hesitate. Call that number right now. Give your testimony. Bible said 12 and 11 in Revelation. You will come through the blood of the Lamb and by the word of your testimony. Testify. Show the devil he's a lie. Amen. Praise God. Until we meet again, I'm Dr. T.J. Straight with Straight Talk Live. And with Jesus Christ in your boat, you cannot sink. TTFN. That means ta-ta for now. Ta-ta. We'll be right back.